mercy and your healing on us, we give you praise. God is worthy to be praised. For the psalmist said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. What a mighty God. What a mighty God. What a mighty God we serve. Good morning again, First Baptist. Giving honor to God and to Jesus Christ, his Son, and the Holy Spirit, our comforter. And in the absence of our pastor and First Lady, Dr. and Mrs. Robert G. Murray, it is good to be here. I thank God for this blessed opportunity. It's always good to be home. I preach away a lot, but I'm more excited sometimes when I get an opportunity to preach at home. Thank Pastor Murray for this opportunity, for the ministerial staff, for being here and support, and for each and every one of you. And again, to my dear friends and cast, it's good to have you here with us, worshiping with us today. Amen. Amen. There is a word from the Lord. And if you have your Bibles with you, we ask that you would turn with us to the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 28 and 29. God's word according to Paul to the church at Rome, chapter 8, verses 28 to 29. God's holy word reads thusly. And we know that in all things God worked for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. The Living Insight Bible, NIV. Amen. From this particular scripture that I've read, like to lift up the topic, walking by faith according to God's purpose. Let us pray. Father God, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, you are my strength and you are my redeemer. Therefore, God, I give you total praise. Now, God, I pray that you will allow Jesus to stand up in me, that your people might see less of me and all of thee. And then I pray, O Lord, for a double portion of the Holy Spirit. God, I pray that you will anoint me afresh and anew, from the crown of my head to the sole of my feet. Speak, Lord, thy servant heareth. Speak, Lord, thy people heareth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Walking by faith according to God's purpose. What do you think of when you hear the word walk or ask to join a walking exercise program? If we are honest with ourselves, oftentimes we pause and respond. I would like to walk more, but I just don't have the time in my busy schedule to fit it in. The long days and hours at work wear me out, and I need to sleep that extra minute in the morning before my day begins. We tend to forget that we are made up of body, soul, and spirit. We spend a lot of time taking care of the outer body with the clothes we wear, the makeup we wear, the hairstyles and haircuts we wear, and for the sisters in the house, the color of our finger and toenail polish. We want our outer body to look good. Yet, on the other hand, we neglect our inner body, our spirit, and our soul, known in the Hebrew language as our nephesh. We forget about our souls, and if the truth be told, we are only dust. The Reverend Dr. A. Lincoln James from Richmond says, we only put a few rags on to cover the dust, for we are nothing but dust. From dust we came, and dust we will return. The body is the shell which houses the real us, for our souls matter. Listen, the human body is a perfect walking machine. God made it plain and make a vital connection so that we can get a Holy Ghost glimpse of the big picture. So I did some research on walking. Walking is one of the natural functions of the human body. Because of the structure, shape, and flexibility of the spine, we are better constructed for walking than sitting, standing, or running. You see, when we sit, the force of gravity exerts a constant pull on the top heavy head and shoulders, making it difficult for the curved spine to maintain its shape. Subsequently, the abdominal muscles relax. This creates more tension on the back and neck muscles, a common cause for vertical neck and lumbosacral spine, which is considered low back pain. Well, we are a little better designed for standing than sitting. We are better for standing than sitting, since the bony pelvic structure and the legs can help support the upper half of the body. For the joggers and runners in the house, when we run, however, we pound the ground with a force equal to 3 or 4 times more of our body weight, producing stress and strain on the spine and the internal organs. Research informed me that when we walk, the skeletal and muscular systems perform together harmoniously. The curved, flexible spine is made up of many vertebrae, each separated from the other by a tiny cushion called a disc, and has a spring-like function to absorb the shock. These intervertebral discs also give the spine flexibility and resistance. Resilience. The legs are made up of hinge-like joints at the knees, ankles, and feet. The hips are composed of ball and socket joints. The muscles that attach to the long bones and the legs and the pelvis are specifically designed, my brothers and my sisters, for walking. The back, the hip, and the legs support the body and propel it forward. The most powerful muscles are located at the back of the hip, the front of the thigh, and the back of the legs. Stay with me, saints. I'm going somewhere. You see, the long bones of the legs form a framework of levers to which these muscles are attached. Now, by a system of contraction and relaxation, these muscles act in unison to move the body forward. The abdominal muscles support the weight of the internal abdominal organs, while the chest wall and the diaphragm help us breathe. In walking, as the legs swing forward, we are actually catching the forward gall of the heavier upper third of the body. In a sense, we are harnessing nature's force of gravity. Come on, somebody. As we walk, we create a near-perfect balance between gravity's pull and this forward motion. Needless to say, walking is constructively an almost effortless, automatic, hydrodynamic process, more beautiful and efficient than man's most advanced machine. This research was taken from the doctor's walking book by Fred A. Stuntman, medical doctor. Perhaps you are saying to yourself, what in the world does this have to do with anything? Well, let me see if I can help a sister and a brother out this morning. For you see, our text says in verse 28, and we know that all things God works for the good for those who love God and who have been called according to his purpose. We all have a purpose. Just as a physical body, and the physical body's purpose is walking to benefit said, our natural health. God has a plan and a purpose for each of our lives. If we would only relate our spiritual walk, come on now, and purpose to the divine will of God, it is my belief we will become a church walking by faith according to God's purpose. Let us define the word purpose. According to the New World Dictionary of American English, purpose is defined as something one intends to get done or do. It is an aim or determination. Most of the time, people don't know what their purpose in life is. Ask the person in church, what is your purpose? And they'll tell you, Brother Small, I don't know what my purpose is. I can't seem to find my purpose in life. Well, all of us have a purpose. We have a purpose to do what the Lord has called us to do. People have very little faith, and oftentimes they just lean on their own understanding. Help me, Lord. But the Bible says, lean not on your own understanding, but in all of thy ways. It says, acknowledge him, and he will. I'm a living witness that he will. He will direct your path. All things work together for the good. All things, not some things, but all things work together for the good. The good, physically, when we walk, the skeleton and the muscular system perform together harmoniously. In other words, they work together for the good of our bodies. I'm so glad that we know that all things work for the good of those who love God and who have been called according to his purpose. Is there anybody in the house this morning who is willing to join me in saying, I love the Lord because he's worked for the good in my life? I love the Lord. I really love the Lord. You don't know what he's done for me, but he's given me the victory. I really love the Lord. You see, each one of us have been called. We've been called, if no more than out of the darkness, into the marvelous light of salvation. Called from a life of sin and shame to a glorious walk in the newness of life with Christ. Walking has its benefits. And if we are walking by faith according to God's purpose, then we will receive some benefits. There will be some improvement in our lives. Attitudes will change. Bad habits will eventually change. And some will be rapidly, and for others, they will gradually disappear. We won't be so petty and always finding fault in people without giving them the benefit of the doubt. We will walk the walk and talk the talk of Christ. Remember, we are a light, a lamp upon a hill for the entire world to see. So the question is, are you walking by faith according to God's purpose in your life? Are you determined to get something done? And are you aiming to do what God has called you to do with the spirit of being intentional about the task? Well, if you are, let us take another look at our text. We've already looked at verse 28. For we know that all things work together for the good of those who have been called by God according to his purpose. All things, not some things. One of the pastors at Westwood Baptist Church, he said in his sermon that I was listening to, he said, all means all, not some things, but all things. He said that when you talk about all, you're talking about everything under the sun of the heavens. But our verse 29 says, for those God knew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many others. Listen, like Jeremiah, God knew us and called us and ordained us before we were formed in our mother's womb. We are no accident. We are no surprise. Some of us who are grandparents today, some of us felt like when our children had children out of wedlock, that was an accident, that it was not foreordained or ordained by God. God makes no mistakes. God doesn't get caught up in drama and accidents. God does what he does because he's God and he's sovereign. We are no accident, nor are we a surprise to God. Whatever we do, God does not throw God off track. What we do or what others do to us sometimes throw us off track, and we find ourselves derailing in life. But I've come by to let somebody know this morning, when we are walking by faith according to God's purpose, we must always remember that we are not in charge of our lives. We are not in charge of our day. God is. And I must contend that he wants us to use our time wisely. He is more concerned with the development of our character and the cultivation of the qualities that make us Christ-like men and women of God. That's our faithful witness to the world. Turn up your spiritual hearing aids and listen carefully. Our intentions and performances in life is directly related to the thoughts we deposit in our memory bank. Walk with me, if you will. Like BB&T, Wells Fargo, Southern Bank, Navy Federal Credit Union, Town Bank, and SunTrust, just to name a few. If we do not deposit anything in the bank, we can't go to the bank and ask for a return. You can expect to make a withdrawal from the bank and you haven't made a monetary deposit. Let me give you some living insight before I take my seat. You see, God is totally committed to the task of conforming you and me to the image of his son. Our God wants us to be conformed to the likeness of Jesus. The image of his son is not a physical image. He's not making us look like Jesus physically, but inwardly, in character, in patience, in gentleness, in goodness, in grace, in good, in truth, and in discipline. Church, we are to carry out his attributes according to God's purpose for our lives. Yes, God is committed to transforming our lives into the inner character of his son. Allow me to make it personal for just a few minutes and give you a conclusion to the whole matter. I must confess that I am a walker. I love to walk. And like many of us, there are times I put off walking for many reasons. Some good, and some, Sister Lydia, not so good. Just because I am in a lazy mood, I may not walk on a certain day. I first began walking about 26 years ago after the death of my first husband, to escape the pressures of life that weighed so heavily upon my shoulders and even more heavily upon my heart. At this particular time in my life, I weighed almost 218 pounds and wore a 22 and a half size dress. 26 years ago, I was 42 years old. I needed to be alone, and so walking became my avenue of escape. I found it refreshing to take a half-hour walk outside of DePaul Hospital at lunchtime to breathe the fresh air and to feel the warm sunshine. Sometimes I would walk in the evening in the cool of the day. I tell you, church, there's something special about the evening breeze, walking and talking with God. And then I started walking early in the morning before the sun rose with two of my neighbors. The more I walked, the better I felt. And the weight began to drop off, slowly but surely. All of my vitals improved medically, and all the things began to work together for my good. Help me, Holy Ghost. Well, as I walked with my neighbor girlfriends, one morning I realized I was walking by faith, according to God's purpose. Because as we walked and talked, they confessed to me that they were not saved. They confessed that I attend church. I've been in church all my life. One of them said, I stand, Gloria, at the door, and I usher people in Sunday after Sunday. The other one said, I sit in the choir. I lift my voice and praise, and I sing God's Zion. And she said, I get happy, but I'm not saved. I said to myself, Lord, they don't know you through the act of salvation. They are saved, not saved. They are saved from danger, hurt, evil, and harm, because you protect us, whether we are saved or not. The Bible says that you reign upon the just as well as the unjust. You protect the saved as well as those who are not saved. And so, God, they are here with me. And I know I've been born again. I know I've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. I know what it means to be saved. And so, my dear sisters and brothers, we have to always be ready to be a witness for the Lord. We have to always be ready to take every opportunity we can while walking by faith according to God's divine purpose. Yes, we must always be ready to be a witness for our Lord. And so we began one morning, we began to talk a little more, and we began to share scripture. I read a scripture before we would take off walking. And then I said to them, I said, now I've read the scripture and we're going to walk. And while we're walking, we're going to talk about what the word is saying to us. Yeah. And so then it turned out to be a walking prayer meeting, a walking Bible study. Yeah. We will always walk and talk about the word of God. We began to discuss the scripture, and our walks became prayer walks as we shared our life journey with one another. We shared the good. We shared the bad. And we even shared some of the ugliest mess that had occurred in our lives. After a year of walking by faith, I took a chance and I stepped out on faith and introduced my sisters to Jesus Christ. I thank God today that Sister Celeste and Sister Donna, they accepted Jesus Christ. They received Christ as a result of our walking together. To the neighborhood, we became the walking trio. I found myself walking by faith in God's purpose, determined to make a difference in the world through the word of God. My brothers and my sisters, every day it seems that things are getting more and more out of control in our world. Within the last couple of weeks, Hurricane Harvey has devastated the state of Texas. This week, we see Hurricane Irma in the making as one of the worst hurricanes that has ever been witnessed. Many people have lost their lives. Many people have lost everything that they've owned, and they've lost loved ones. There is much more to come as we see what Irma is doing in Miami. Our nation's leadership is off the chain, while people are suffering, frightened, anxious, and even perplexed. Frustrations over life situations are on the rise every day as we witness terrorism around the world, and not to mention Charlottesville incident just a few weeks ago. I've come by with some good news this morning, and that is prayer is the key. And faith unlocks the door. No matter how dark or bleak things may look, I heard in the word by God that the just shall live by faith. Come on, somebody. We must stop sucking and jiving when it comes to our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. God is trying to tell us it is time to get our house in order and start walking by faith according to God's purpose for our lives. We got to walk on by faith, knowing and believing that the Lord is walking with us. Take a step forward and look back behind you. You'll see that he's there. Take another step and look beside you. You'll see that he's there. Step by step, he's there. Take another step and look ahead of you. He's there also, leading the way. I don't know about you, but I'm walking with my Savior. I'm walking all the way from earth to glory. Sometimes in my life, the road gets rough and the going gets tough. Sometimes in my life, the hills are very hard to climb. But I started out, praise God, from Zion a long time ago. And I made up in my mind that I make Jesus my choice. So I'm walking by faith according to God's purpose. Well, as I close my message and take my seat, let me introduce you to someone and to some and to others. Let me go back. Let me introduce to some and introduce to others a man who's been walking for a mighty long time. He's a man who walks on water. He's a man who walked on the dusty roads of Philippi and on the shores of Galilee. Capernaum was his stopping ground, and Nazareth was his home. One Friday morning, he took a dreadful walk up to a hill far away, a hill called Calvary, carrying an old rugged cross, a remnant of suffering and shame, after being mocked and beaten and bruised all night long. Oh, he walked up to the hill. He was nailed to that old rugged cross. He was nailed there for you and me. They pierced him in his side, and the blood came streaming down. Oh, yes, he died. He died on that old rugged cross. Jesus was walking in his purpose. Jesus was walking by faith according to God's purpose. But early, early one Sunday morning, my Lord, my Savior, Jesus got up from the grave. Bible says he got up with all power in his hands. I thank God for salvation. First Baptist, we have to just keep on walking according to God's purpose, for it is the perfect and holy will of God. I don't know about you, but I've been walking by faith for a mighty long time. I've been leaning and trusting and depending on God. Church, I found out for myself that it's a highway to heaven, and I'm walking up the King's highway. It's a highway to heaven, and none can walk up there but the pure in heart. It's a highway to heaven, and I'm walking up the King's highway. My way gets brighter. My load gets lighter walking up the King's highway. There's joy in knowing and going with him walking up the King's highway. I don't have to worry. Don't have to hurry, because I'm walking up the King's highway. When I'm walking, Christ is beside me. Angels is beside me to guide me walking up the King's highway. If you're not walking while I'm talking, I believe you ought to start walking. Walking up the King's highway. There's a blessing you'll be possessing walking up the King's highway. Step by step. I'm walking by faith according to God's purpose. And someday I'll make it home. Someday, I'll walk up to the pearly gates of heaven. Someday, I'll walk on the streets of gold. Someday, I'll see my aunts and uncles. Someday, I'll see my cousins. Someday, I'll see my son again. Someday, someday, I'll see Jesus. I'll kneel at his feet. I'll worship him in person. I'll give honor. I give glory because I've had an opportunity to walk up the King's highway. I'm walking step by step. Step by step. Step by step. I'm walking on the King's highway. Walking by faith according to God's purpose. Is there anybody in the house this morning that want to step out and walk with me? That want to walk when people say you ought to sit down and shut up, but you want to keep on walking? Is there anybody in the house this morning that just want to walk up the King's highway? Walk on up there and see what the end's going to be. Walk by faith according to God's purpose. Let us pray. Holy Father, somebody couldn't get off the bed this morning to do a physical walk. Somebody needed nurses and aides to help them off their beds. They couldn't take a step physically. But God, they could walk spiritually because they know you, Lord. Through life, they build a relationship with you, God. They know that all things work together for the good of them that love you and are called according to your purpose. God, thank you for allowing us to be able to walk physically and spiritually. Thank you for helping us to see that we can do all things through Christ, who strengthens us. And so God, we've been walking a long time. And every day and every step we take is closer to heaven's gate. So Lord, we thank you for allowing us to walk according to your purpose. But not just walk, but to walk by faith. God, we ask that you will keep us in your care. When we get weak, God, we pray that you'll make us strong. And when we fall by the wayside, God, we ask that you will pick us up, dust us off, put us back on the right track. Don't let us derail in the drama of life. But let us keep our eyes on the prize as we walk up the King's highway. Bless the word, God, that has gone forward. And let it not return unto you void, but let it do what you have called it to do. Bless those that are here. Hear our word, God. Hear our words, God. In Jesus' name. As we remain standing, and there may be one this morning who haven't been walking with God by faith. You've been doing your physical walks in the mornings, the afternoons, and maybe in the evening. But you haven't taken hold of God's hand spiritually, and you haven't walked by faith according to his divine purpose. We extend to you the invitation of discipleship. We ask that you will walk the aisles of faith. Come forward and give us your hand and give God your heart. We extend the invitation of discipleship. Is there one? Please come. Please come. Grab hold of God's hand. Walk with him. Walk with him. He'll walk with you. Yes, he will. The song says, I want Jesus to walk with me. It's one thing for you to walk with God, but it's another thing when you know that God is walking with you. Is there one? Church. Please join us. Yes, I want Jesus to walk with me. No one be alone at this time. Reach out and touch the next brother or sister next to you. Father God, we want you to walk with us as we walk with you. We can't make it in this life without you, God. You have to lead us. You have to guide us. God, you have to walk before us. You have to walk behind us and even beside us because we need you, dear Lord. When you walk with us, God, you can see what's ahead. And when you see what's ahead, God, you protect us from all evil, hurt, danger, and harm. Thank you, Lord. And we say thank you, God. Thank you. We thank you for every blessing in our lives, God. We thank you, God, for just being there, providing for us everything that we need.
according to your riches in glory by Christ Jesus. God, we want to just lift up some names. We want to lift up Sister Fanny Banks and her family, the loss of her sister, Sister Cynthia Thorne. We lift up, God, Sister Deaconess Bernice Washington Cox, and Sister, we lift up Sister Barbara Gibbs. God, we lift up Sister Rosa Edwards, her family that's in Miami, Florida. We lift up Sister Jasmine and Maurice Ramsua in Florida, God. We lift up God's Sister Adrian Johnson, the daughter of Deaconess Phyllis Crater in Antonia, Texas, and all that they're doing to help their fellow citizens in Houston. God, we lift up all of those who've been evacuated, those who are still in shelters in Texas, and those who've just entered in Florida. Lord God, we pray that you will be with those families, and even those, God, who have made dangerous decision of staying home, trying to protect their home, God, and not realizing that they can replace material things, but they can't place lives. God, we just pray for them. We just ask, Lord, that you would just be there, God. Turn that storm around. We know you can do it if it's your holy will, God. God, we pray for our nation. We pray for our leaders, God. We pray for the one in the White House who don't know what side he's on. He's on one side one day and the other side the next day, because it's like a little kid trying to have his own way. God, help him, help him, help him, help him, help him. He needs help, God. He needs to walk with you physically and spiritually, Lord. Heavenly Father, we pray for our community. We ask that you will bless our community, and thank you for the mayor of Norfolk who wants to bring the unity to community together in unity. And then we pray, God, for all the events that are happening around us. The people, God, who are reaching out and trying to make differences to help people to know that you are here and you're God, and that you can work with them. They just need to be able to turn to you, Lord, and turn from their wicked ways. God, we pray for Pastor and Mrs. Murray as they just completed these 34 years and embark upon the new year of 35 years of being pastor of First Baptist Church. God, we pray for all of us around this altar and standing around these pews holding hands. We pray for the ones on our right hand and the one on our left hand. We pray for God for whatever they stand in need of. We don't have to know, God. You already know. And while we're sometimes trying to figure out stuff, you're already working it out because you're God. You're healing our bodies, God, because you're God. You're opening doors for us, God, because you're God. You're closing doors for us, God, because you're God. You're doing what you do because you're God. And we say thank you, God. Thank you, God. We give you the honor, God. We give you the glory and the praise because you are worthy of all our praise. God, help us, Lord, to just take one day at a time, one step at a time, and let us, God, come together in love and unity and harmony. God, we ask that you would just hear our prayer today. Bless us in a special way. In Jesus' name, we ask it all. Yes. Amen, 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 yes. Amen, and amen. Praise God. Amen. Give the Lord a hand of praise. He's worthy. He's worthy of all our praise. This time, we want to thank you for joining us this morning. Continue to be with us at the hour for study. Church school opportunity. It's always good to study. I learned a long time ago when I started Sunday school here regularly at First Baptist. I never will forget it. It was one Sunday morning in Sunday school. We had this great lesson, and I just learned a lot and came up here to the sanctuary, and Reverend Taylor began to preach, and he preached about what we had studied. And he started using words and explaining. And I said to him, I said, hot dog, I know that. I learned that in Sunday school. Amen, amen. So we learn in Sunday school, and it helps us to understand when we get to our regular service. Thank you, Bad Girls of the Bible Cast, my sisters in Christ, for worshiping with us today. Amen. God bless you. Have a blessed day. And at this time, we're going to close with our closing song, Go. We come in to receive the word, but we are to go out and make disciples. Amen.
Go ye therefore and teach all nations. Go,
go,
go.
Go,
go ye therefore and teach all nations. Go, go,
go.
Baptizing him in the name of the Father, the Son, and Holy Ghost. Go, go, go.
Donations for the hurricane victims. Thank you, please. Thank you.